one.
Hey, hi everyone. Welcome to our YouTube live session. We're going to get started in about a minute to let a few more people join in.
I like your shirt, John.
If you watch the trailer, you know I wear the same shirt for every one of these episodes. It's like my lucky shirt.
The Pepcast shirt.
All right, so why don't we get started? Thanks everyone for joining. We'll just do some quick introductions before we dig in. My name is Charlie Ogden. I'm a product manager here at Autodesk, and I'm focused on grading and drainage features in our infrastructure products.
I'm Val Koch. I'm a research engineer at Autodesk, and I'm focused on optimization, especially grading optimization.
I'm John Sayer. I'm a technical marketing manager here at Autodesk, and I'm sure that hopefully some of you have seen some of the videos we created. We create technical assets on these subjects that we're talking about today. So there's a lot of stuff out there on YouTube that you can watch on our YouTube channel. It's the ADSK Infrastructure YouTube channel. And we do have a lot of good content on there around this subject. So what Charlie's going to go through today is just kind of piggybacking on top of that. So Charlie, go ahead and take it away. I'll be answering questions, by the way. If you've got questions, you can put them in the chat there and we'll try and answer them best we can. So.
Yep. Sounds good. All right. Yeah. So as you may see, today's session is part four of our six YouTube Live Ask Me Anything sessions. We put these together to, you know, help people understand how grading optimization for Civil 3D works. And under the video in the description area, you'll find links to the other sessions. So the other three, in case you missed those, the last three that we did, plus the upcoming future sessions. So set reminders for those. And yeah, feel free to tell us where you're joining from. And as John said, he's going to answer questions. So if you have questions as we go, just write them in the chat. We'll try to answer those. John will try to answer those as we go. And at the end, if we still have questions in there, we'll leave some time for a Q&A session. All right. Why don't we get started? I'll share my screen here. So what we're talking about today is mass grading with grading optimization. And we want to grade this site. It's pretty much, there's a river over here on the right and a stream coming into it. And there's a road cutting down through here and our site is in between in this area. But you can see it's a bit of a rough terrain. I think part of it was developed before, but so what we want to do is use the grading tools to kind of flatten this out, have a nice level site that maybe will, maybe this will get broken up later in the future, but grade it out, mass grade it out to kind of level it off, and then it can be broken up later. So we'll want to balance the grading as we do this. And we'll start with setting a grading limit.
Actually, talking about grading limit, a good grading limit is actually crucial for, well, it's not even just for mass grading, but in general. The reason for that is that the points along the grading limit, they will be fixed at the existing ground. So it will, the grading optimizer will make sure that they stay where they are in the beginning. And if you look at this riverbank, it's sometimes it's very steep and uneven. So if you just take a line and you draw like a straight line over all these contours, obviously you're going to end up is your grading limit going over some really steep points, and your slopes there might be conflicting with the maximum slope that you want. And Charlie is actually going to show an example like that, where it's really bad, so that you understand why actually a good grading limit is crucial.
Yeah, so just briefly as an example, this is really steep in this area, you can tell by the contours. So if I come in here and turn this into a grading limit, did I lose my polyline? Oh, interesting. All right.
Just draw a new one.
Yeah, just going to draw that.
So this is not pre-recorded. It's all live. You can see.
There we go. All right. So here's the polyline. Add this as our grading limit. And I'm just going to leave it at zero. And 33 is the max slope. But this is very steep in this area. It's steeper than 3:1 or 33. So we'll go to optimize this. And run it. And as soon as we run it, we get a message, little feedback that's new in 2023, just to let you know when there are possible issues with the optimization. So in this case, there's a couple messages down here.
Yeah, the first one talks about edges of grading limit are too steep to meet the max slope constraint. That's basically what I mentioned. So his polygon goes through areas where it's more than 33%. And of course, the solver now doesn't know what to do. On one side, you can ask him, maintain 33% everywhere. But on the other hand, you have a grading limit where it says fix these points that are greater than 33. So what you can do is you increase the slope or you draw a grading limit. The one below, the message says that the terrain within the grading limit is too steep. So when you can see at the bottom, it does this pre-check first. So in the pre-check, it goes along your grading limit and it's like looking across and looks if it's steep, and if it sees it's more than your max slope, then this warning appears.
All right, so we'll go back to Civil 3D and we'll make sure we do our grading limit for our site a little more carefully. So close this. And what I've done is so in this surface here, actually, we don't want to grade below this contour line here, which is, I think, 330.
High water line, right?
Yeah, the blue line here. So what I'm going to do is actually create a grading limit that follows that contour. That way it's not crossing these slopes. And we can kind of get some hints as to where steep areas are, right? If you turn on your slope analysis, and I preset it so it's 33% or 3:1. So anything greater than 3:1 is showing up red. And of course, in the area we just kind of tried out, that's all red over there, but also along the where I want my grading limit to be, there's a lot of red. If we look at this first area, I actually had an alignment under there underneath just because I wanted to show another way to look at this. It would be just to create a profile along where you're planning to put your grading limit. if you're having issues, and just see where it's steeper. So I created an arrow in here that's 3-1 or 33%. So you can see a lot of this is too steep along this path. And then any triangles on the surface that, you know, one side, so 2 points and one edge is along this grading limit, that's not going to be able to you know, flatten out to 33% because these points along here, as Val said, can't change. They're fixed. The one interior could change, but that's still not going to get you flat enough if one whole side is steeper than 3-1 already. Mm-hmm. So that's why what we're going to do is I'm going to turn on a layer here. I've extracted that contour from the surface. And so I have a polyline from that, and then joined it along the right of way, along this edge, and then just came back into the contour along the river. So even though this passes through a lot of really steep areas, it's following the path that's flat. Where you might run into this issue if you came kind of perpendicular to some of these, particularly around this this area there, and also tying back in if you're too steep in some of those areas. So this is just one way you kind of minimize the slopes that you cross with your grading limit. And now if I turn this into a grading limit here. Just kind of rename it. So that's the 33%, and I still have the other one. So
I'm going to turn off, right?
Yeah, I'll remove that grading limit just with a right click. So the polyline's still there. I'm just taking off the grading constraints from it.
By the way, you could have multiple grading limits. There's nothing that prevents you from having that. Good examples for that is, for example, if you have solar farms or wind farms where you have different patches on the terrain and you want to balance between them. So you would have multiple grading limits there.
All right, we'll go back to grading optimization.
Oh, by the way, this site, I think we mentioned this in the announcements, it's 150 acres. So that's 60 hectares for the metric people, to a pretty large site for mass grading. So
Val, we should be exact. It's actually 151.44 acres. Just wanted to make sure that we're clear on that, right?
Sorry that I said that wrong. Okay, right. To the 151.4 acre site.
All right, so we're back in Geo. How should we set our objectives here? Does this look good, Val, right?
Yeah, the one thing is, now, yeah, let's talk objectives. We talked about them in the first couple, and here in the first couple of webcasts, here we're doing mass grading. So one thing here, so balancing is something you always want in mass grading. Smoothing the surface usually too, because you want this to either sell this parcel or you want to subdivide it and you want to present it to somebody. So you want nice contours there. Now, what about minimize earthwork? Well, let's just try quickly, Charlie. Run this with one. We have to minimize earthwork on one, which basically minimizes your cut and fill volumes. Now, look at these weird contours that's creating here, these hills, these moons. If you turn the volume visualization on, Charlie, no, the visualization, yeah.
Okay, I get rid of this like that.
This grading. So you can see kind of where these existing paths are. And of course, if you minimize earthwork, means the same as stay as close as possible to the EG. And of course, here it now tries to, you know, it's doing a compromise between smoothing and between staying where the existing ground was. And in this case, it's a brownfield grading we're doing. So mass grading like this on an existing ugly terrain, you want to turn the minimizer strip off. It's just going to be nicer. Of course, if your EG is already quite nice, then you can maybe minimize your cut fills. But here, I would turn it off. Yeah.
Yep. So I'll set it to zero. Just reset this. Run it again. So now it's smoothing out those existing mounds.
Now, if we look at the volumes, we can see it doesn't balance quite. I'll let Charlie talk about this.
Yeah, so we found a little issue here. I think this is showing up because this site is so large. Haven't noticed it on smaller sites, but as it's balancing, it's not really going near zero. It looks like 114 cubic feet. So what I'm going to do is just stop this. And we have this option in here. If this is meant for if you don't want to balance to zero, but you want to balance to some other number, maybe you want to have some material left over so you can put in a number here, or you want to take it away and use somewhere else. You have some somewhere else that you want to put in, you can put in a negative number here. So that's how you typically use this, but I'm going to put in a negative of what it's coming up. Should I do the 114, you think?
Something like that. So this is a workaround for this issue that we found on really large sites. We think we know what the problem can be, and this will be fixed in upcoming versions.
You can see it's a lot. It's 100 cubic feet now instead of 100,000.
That's actually the advantage when you watch these webcasts, you get like workarounds to known issues.
So that's balancing better, but it's creating a mound here, and you know our grading limit was 3:1. So this could get to be a pretty steep mound as it continues, which we probably don't want if our purpose is to mass grade this and kind of level it out. So what we're gonna do is put in a flatter area inside, kind of inside our grading limit, a bit of an offset.
Yeah, it's a grading pad, we call it in mass grading. So we go back to civil for that.
And in here, I already have this polyline drawn. So this is, you know, in from my grading limit down around here, follows the right of way. Give it a little flexibility to grade. So it's not, you know, it can grade down to the river.
But this doesn't need to follow a contour, obviously, because these points along this grading path, they're not going to be fixed, right? So it's not the same as the grading limit. So here you can just draw like Charlie did freely.
And I'll turn this into a zone. And so I want to flatten this one out. That's what we're trying to do here. So I'll make this 5% instead of 33. So inside this area, it'll flatten it to 5%, but outside of it, within the grading limit, you'll still be allowed to go 3:1. And I'll run optimization.
You run it. Now we can see it's already platter, showing nice, this grading pad. But you can see from the contours, you can see in the middle, it's still creating this little hill there. The reason is it can. We don't tell it to do anything else. So it's just free to do whatever it wants. It's, even if it's doing the same thing as before, basically, just at 5% now instead of 33. So one way we can now change that is, Charlie, you want to show?
Yep. Yeah, so this might be fine too. I mean, it's at 5%. Maybe that's okay to have it mounted. But, you know, since we have the river down here, we were going to try and grade it all the way down towards the river from the road. So if we go into the zone, we have this minimum drain inclination setting. Oh, and I need to stop it so I can change this. So what this will do is let us enter in a direction, and then it'll try to get, you know, the minimum slope to flow in that direction that I specify. So I could type it in, but I don't know where the angles are here. So there's a little button here to pick it in the drawing. And you could start anywhere and then just come off in the direction that you want this inclination direction to go in. But notice I'm not really seeing anything right now. If you have exaggeration on, actually it's raising it way up, you can see there. So if I bring that down, then you can see where the direction is. So I'm just gonna go somewhere kind of perpendicular to the river. All right. 320-ish.
What is actually the black line, Charlie? Is that
what's that?
Black line that showed.
Yeah, that's your zero.
Ah, oh, that's zero.
Yeah. So I'm just gonna round this out a little.
Well, John likes these precise numbers, so he could leave them.
And then to use an inclination direction, I need a minimum slope here. So it's, what it's going to do is try to get at least 1% in this direction. If it's zero, it's not going to change anything. So then I'll run it again. And now we see it's tending down towards the river more.
Now, can you exaggerate a little bit, Charlie? Now, when we look in front of the zone to where, at the river,
yeah,
it's creating this little wall in front. The reason is it's why is it doing this? It's because it needs to reach these 1% that Charlie wanted. But if you look at the back of the property, this grading pad is like attached there. So it's like on a hinge. So yeah, exactly there. So it can't really do anything then tilt down towards the river, and there it's gonna just dig into the riverbank. So what we need to do is we need to give it a little bit of freedom in the back so that it can lift this whole grading pad. Otherwise, it's just going to fill up this little wall in front. So
what I probably need is a different grading pad here, right? Not one that ends along the right of way, which is also the grading limit. So we'll go back to Civil 3D then, since I need a different object. So not this one, because this follows the grading limit. And turn on another layer here where I've already drawn one that's offset now also along the grading limit along the right of way. So it's free to move on actually on all four sides. and then the grading limit will control what happens outside of that area. So I'll select this as a zone and I'll give it the same properties, one, and also the inclination direction. Now you could set this also from Civil 3D, or I could type it in since I know what it is, but I'll just show setting it here in Civil. Same idea, pick a first point. It's showing you the zero direction, and then you can just come off somewhere in that general direction. Or like I said, type it in if you want.
5% max length.
Yeah. Oh, yes. I want to flatten that out. Yeah. Yeah. So same as the grading pad we had before, which actually is still here, right? So I want to get rid of that one. So I'm going to remove the zone from this first one that goes right up against the grading limit. All right, so now we just have our grading limit and this grading pad that's offset a little bit. And we'll go back to grading optimization. We'll run this again.
Now, if you exaggerate again, well, we can already see that this wall is gone. So now it's grading nice down to the river. Now the contours, they look quite nice, but I don't know if you would want to send like GPS controlled machines. It's still a little curvy, right? What do you think?
Yeah. So yeah, like you said, this is probably good, but we can just show a way to kind of flatten it out too. If we go into this zone. So I don't think we've really talked about this one before, right? The aligned surface property?
No, I don't think we ever used this, no.
So at least just to show how this works, the purpose of this is to align the whole zone to kind of a flat plane of a the surface to a flat plane. A plane. Inclined plane, and in this case, you know, it's gonna still kind of tilt towards 345 degrees, but this could actually be off too, and that way it would have a little flexibility on what direction it inclines at. But in our case, we want it still to go down towards the river, so I'll leave that on. And then just to show what that does, we'll run this. And you'll see it smooths that out so it's all one consistent slope going down.
Now it's nice and the riverbank is nice and steep now. In the back, it's nice and steep to drain away from the pad to the road. So this looks, what about the volumes? Can we quickly check the volumes? Here we didn't adjust. Maybe you want to try our trick again?
Yeah, so.
I mean, even this is a cubic yard. That's... Well,
yeah, I mean, if I turn this to zero, just to show this again, I think it's... tending towards 100. So if I put in a negative. Oops, and I'll just reset it.
This looks better. I mean, it's quite a big site, so getting.
And that's in cubic feet, not cubic yards.
Yeah. So we're right now in what sphere?
In hundreds, it did just kind of go negative.
Goes up and down, yeah.
It's kind of fluctuate, let it run for a bit, but it's still trying to solve some triangles over here, which it looks like it did now.
If I take that 800 cubic feet and divide it by 27, and we're at about 29 cubic yards. Is that bad for a 151.4-acre site, John?
No, it is not. You think about grading something like this that's that big, using the traditional tools inside of Civil 3D. Now, I don't want to make it sound like it's difficult. It's not. You know, we use feature lines and grading objects. And you could grade that, but what it saves you is the iteration process of balancing, right? So even though we do have a workaround for that, it's still balancing the site. So yeah, it's a huge time saver.
Yeah, and this could have been a lot quicker. We kind of did some purposeful mistakes to go back and forth. Really, we're just setting up a grading limit and a grading level area, which you could probably do pretty quickly in a lot shorter time than we actually did, just to point things out as we went. So I think that's it, right, Val?
That's it. Anything? No, it was simple but powerful today.
All right.
We do. There is one question here that I've gotten. Is there a limit to how many grading limits you can have in one model?
Val, you want to take that?
There shouldn't be, right? Not really. There's no limit. The limit is probably your hardware that can handle it. But
yeah, so if you wanted distinct areas to grade without grading in between them, you might do that.
Yeah.
Hippo was kind of quiet today in the chat box. So,
all right.
It's really the only questions that we had.
All right. So, I guess we're good. Thanks everyone for joining. Again, this will be saved on our channel. So, feel free to watch it again, or maybe watching it now from the recording. Also, don't forget, we have two more. I think the next one, we're going to grade a subdivision. So that one should be a little more exciting maybe than this one. But yeah, set your reminder for the upcoming sessions as well. You'll, again, find those links below this video, as well as the ones we've done in the past that are already recorded. So last time, John looked at grading a pond. In the earlier ones, we were kind of doing some introductory information there. So, yeah, thanks everyone for your time.
Charlie, yep, I did get another question.
All right.
Says, is it possible to switch between cubic yards and cubic feet in volumes? Says they've requested that before, but I'll let you go ahead and address that.
Yeah, not yet. Right now, the units are just using what basically if Civil 3D is set to meters or feet, and then it's just bringing over the units, whether it's linear area or volumes are all based on that one unit. It's come up. I think it's probably something we'd like to kind of enable a way to choose what units for different things, but not right now, sorry.
Okay, that's all we got.
All right, cool. So thanks again, everyone. Thanks John for being online to help out with the questions, and everyone else in the background. So everyone have a great day, and we'll see you again soon. Thanks.
Bye.
See you, everyone.
Yeah, thanks.